Next week is a very big deal because it marks the release of the IPCC AR6WG1, which, if you're a climate nerd like me, is incredibly exciting news, and if you're relatively normal, probably sounds like a not very intelligent child trying and failing to learn the alphabet.
IPCC AR6.
The IPCC is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and this is its sixth major report. These reports are treated by scientists and policymakers as the backbone of our understanding of climate change. But what actually are these IPCC reports? And what is the IPCC for that matter? The IPCC was founded in 1988, and its first report came out 2 years later in 1990. The point was to summarise what we understand about climate change and how to stop it in a way that would be useful to the governments around the world. As our understanding of climate change has expanded, so have these reports. The first one was around 1,000 pages long, but the most recent, which came out in 2013-2014, was over 4,000 pages long. The reports haven't just got longer, they've also got starker as it's become clearer that we are changing our planet, and just how severe the consequences of those changes will be. For just one example, in the very first IPCC report, they concluded that it was too early to say if we were changing the planet's temperature, whereas the most recent report concluded that it was 95% likely that humans were driving the observed temperature changes. Just to be clear about what the IPCC reports do and do not do, the point is to sum up all the knowledge that we have, so looking at all the research that exists out there and putting it together, the IPCC does not do its own original research from scratch. So who actually writes these reports? Well, they're written by experts in the relevant subjects, so that includes people like physicists, atmospheric and oceanic scientists, energy specialists, economists, and so on. And they take into account thousands of comments in a review process before publishing the reports. Now, just as a reminder, my background is in climate science. I have a doctorate in atmospheric physics from the University of Oxford. And disclaimer that while I personally have never worked on the IPCC reports and probably never will, I do know a bunch of people who have and currently are. But that's really not saying very much because the reports are authored by hundreds of scientists and researchers around the world. So if you've worked on climate science, chances are you know a bunch of people who make these reports happen. But you may have noticed that the I in IPCC does not stand for international, interdisciplinary, or even inspirational. It stands for intergovernmental. So what do governments have to do with these fundamentally scientific reports? Well, firstly and most importantly, governments own the reports. The IPCC is made up of representatives from 195 countries who commission the reports from academics. Since these reports are meant to serve governments and negotiations around the world, all the different governments actually have to agree that they're on board with them. In practice, that means that governments can leave comments on drafts of the main report, which the authors can take into account while they're redrafting. In practice, though, governments don't have a say in what goes into the final draft. That's left up to the academics, and governments just have to sign off on the final version. Each section of the report also has what's called a summary for policymakers, and this is another story. As this is the essential bit that governments use, there is fierce debates between representatives from governments and the academics writing the report over each and every single sentence and graph. And as I currently speak, that debate is taking place for the first section of the report. This can lead to certain language being tweaked or weakened or even outright removed. But crucially, nothing can be introduced that's not backed up by research. So if one government says, "We propose replacing this entire section with the phrase, clean coal rules, then that's just not going to happen. And what's more, the main report always contains everything that the authors originally wanted to be included. But what about the biases of the scientists? Maybe they just say particular things for all that IPCC money. Well, that's a good point. How much do you think all these researchers get paid to take all this time out of their normal research and teaching and other responsibilities? What do you think would be fair? $10,000? $20,000? Maybe even $100,000? Well, whatever you're thinking, double it. And then times it by zero, because that's how much the authors of the IPCC reports get paid. $0. They literally do it for free. They do this work because they see the inherent value of these reports. And sure, maybe for a little bit of clout. So are these reports perfect? Well, of course not. There are plenty of criticisms of these reports from climate scientists and from others. These range from talking about how slow the process is to the idea that by working through consensus, the reports soften any conclusions that they draw. Though it's worth noting that many climate scientists that I know strongly disagree with this second critique. So no, they're not perfect. But I think it's fair to say that for reports that are this comprehensive and that are of this magnitude, they serve both the scientific and policy communities remarkably well. What's more, since governments own them and have signed off on them, they can't show up later and say, "Oh, we didn't know what the climate science was," because they've literally signed off on these reports which have outlined it. So here's what happens next. The sixth report is split up into three sections: the physical science basis, impact, adaptation and vulnerability, and mitigation of climate change. I was really close. In August 2021, about a week from when I'm recording this, the first section on the physical science basis will be released. The other two sections will be released later in 2022. So what we'll be hearing next week in the first section is the definitive view on questions like how much has the world warmed, how fast are sea levels rising, how important are different pollutants, and what might the future hold. What we won't get is a detailed breakdown of human impacts of climate change, or what we can do to adapt to these impacts, since those will go in the second section. We also won't have a detailed idea of what we can do to stop climate change by cutting greenhouse gases, since those will go into the third section. And by the way, this first section is what all those letters at the beginning of this video referred to. So IPCC, Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, AR6, that's the sixth assessment report, so sixth major report, WG1, Working Group 1, which refers to this first section, the physical science basis. This first section of the report is being published in time to help inform the negotiations taking place in Glasgow and starting in October of this year. And previous IPCC reports have had a huge influence. So, for example, the special report on 1.5 degrees of global warming had a massive impact, not just on policymakers, but also our public discussion of climate change and our understanding of what we consider a safe level of global warming. So, honestly, I am extremely curious to see what this report might say. Just so much has changed in climate science and in the climate itself since the last report was released. And I'm going to be trying my best to summarize the key findings of the report here on this channel, so make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss that video. And drop a comment in the comments below, where else, with your predictions of what the report might emphasize. Okay, until next time. Bye.